thank you very much for the kind invitation. So first of all, it's a little bit to introduce the lab then. So indeed, it's not competitor with what Turaz does, because we are the, I'm heading the laboratory of embedded systems. So basically what we work on is to building all the electronics that make possible to have this new technology of wearables. Okay, so that's the idea of what we do behind. Not on the not much on the signal processing, yes, on how to map the algorithms on the embedded systems lab and the embedded systems and so on, and how to create this intelligence on these smart wearables. So the first thing that I have to do is actually a bit of a disclaimer. So what are smart wearables? Well, there are plenty of wearable systems today. So there are even more that are more about things that you wear in clothing, that are on fashion and so on. All these things that are what I consider simple electronics, I'm not going to touch. I'm going to touch more what is, from this point of view of really electronics, advanced electronics, how to make them more intelligent. That's the idea. And how to make them more intelligent at the same time that we want to consume as little as possible. Okay? And in particular, the main reason why we started working on this is because for the last 50 years, we saw a huge progress on the electronics. So we used to work on simple machines like this. And then suddenly, you see that the convergence made for Moore's Law for the last 50 years, we see that typical technologies that were only dedicated to extremely high-end dedicated systems started being portable and in the end merged in these electronics. And later on, you see that there's as much electronics and knowledge in building these smart wearables as what you have actually in the high-end systems. And the computing power I'm going to show you a bit later are really, really comparable. So in reality today, when you talk about embedded systems, it's very difficult to distinguish what is the difference in technology between an embedded system and an actual computer. In fact, my laptop, my only util for working, is not a laptop anymore, it's a tablet that has a keyboard. So in reality, this is what is smart wearables. Okay? So how to design smart wearables today? Interestingly enough, because people think that there is a distinction between manufacturers, Intel started working on embedded systems. So the first prototype was for the calculator in 1971. Okay? So then they saw that it was much more profitable business to compete with IBM, and they moved to PCs. And later on, actually 2 weeks ago, they announced that they want to go back to elements like this, which is where they see the, really the market growing. So you can see there's not even anymore in the manufacturers, from the manufacturer perspective, what is going to be the real future. And Intel even, they are actually moving into this area. And you have a clear announcement that they say that Intel will start focusing on building ARM-based smartphone chips. So this is the new business. That's what they're going to do. Okay? They have announced it end of August. So it's not that it's really something that has been changed. It's going to be for the next 5 years. So they are going to make deals with Apple and Qualcomm to help them design the new generations of smartwatches, for example. So from that point of view, we think what is the Internet of Things, and wearables a key aspect on this concept. You see, and that is a very interesting study that first was done by different consultant companies, but later on I saw last month a report from the European Commission and the US National Science Foundation. They all agree that wearables are going to play a key aspect on what is called Internet of Things, which is the idea of everybody connected, but not everybody only, but also objects connected with themselves and trying to communicate with each other. So from that point of view, you see that wearables, connected cars, connected cities will be continuously monitored. And once they are continuously monitored and you get enough information, this will enable to have cloud computing. So things, everything sent to the cloud and come up with different algorithms that will help you to take decisions at the global scale, coming from machine learning and big data analysis features. So this is the concept of Internet of Things that this pursues today. So my question is, will this work? And what I'm going to try to convince you is, if we do it as we do it today, it will not. That's the claim. So let me try to focus in one area, because there are many areas, smart cities, industry 4.0, healthcare. So in particular, I'm going to try to show you a clear case study with the medicals. So in this case, with the healthcare. So if we think about the context where IoT will help healthcare and wearable systems that are typically very often thought of a nice way of monitoring humans, you think that the idea that what they can do is to change this current trend that is showing already since 2006 that we have a lot of problems on the way we live, not because of infectious organisms, but on the way that we physically live, which is our habits. We don't do enough exercise. We tend to eat too much. But we don't really have the habit of doing gradual control of what we eat or we don't eat. So all these things are really having a big problem on the healthcare system, in the sense that it's expected to be more than 75% of GDP by 2030 in the US. So what it means, basically, it means that we need to change, not to have more vaccinations and more treatments against diseases, but really to change how we live. And we are not enough to do that. Why? Because in 2006, the World Health Organization showed it was 50% the type of personal lifestyle-induced problems that we have in civilized or really developed countries. They made an update in 2013. Interesting enough, it's not 55%, it's 50, it's not 50%, it's 55%. So we're not getting better, we're getting worse. Basically, it means that humans are very difficult to be regular and controlled, as we know, but also very difficult to even tell them suggestions that are good and follow. So we need to have something else to change that. And the idea is that these wearables can help us to change the way that we live by having clear analysis for each person to do that. So the idea is that we move to something that is symptom-based for healthcare to something that is more preventive. We will know what's going on much ahead of what happens, and we tend to make much cheaper treatments for this type of mechanisms. And we want to also go away from hospitals to do something that's person-centered, and ideally most of the treatments can be done at home. Okay? So in that environment, clearly wearables and can be really a dramatic change on the way that we do healthcare today. Is it possible? So if I take the case of cardiovascular monitoring, why? Because it's a very typical example that we all know. I think everybody knows what an ECG is, at least from the movies and TV, I think, appears very often. So this is clear. So this is a typical state-of-the-art ECG holter, which is a monitoring device that you have in the hospital, medically certified to monitor how a person is. It's a recording device. So it's a data logging device that registers this type of signal for a period between 3 to 5 days. And then you go to the hospital, you bring the device, and they analyze it. Obviously, not everybody wears this. Even though they claim it's wearable, I don't think it's very wearable. And nobody likes to use it. So basically, you only use it when you don't have, you don't have any choice, basically. So from this, that was the, and is still today, the state of the art, they started proposing the idea, well, why don't we have a number of sensors that actually can monitor us in a bit better way than this, and not only they do data logging, but send the data to some kind of intermediate hub, and from there, we do this analysis on the cloud. Well, we have been working in this area since 2008. There were many projects that came up with the same idea, obviously many sensors, patches, watches that came up with these ideas, and then they transmit to the hub, nice interfaces and so on, and we try to see if this works. What do? They send the raw biosignal, not to lose any data, to the hub, and the hub is the one that calculates and analyzes all this. For two reasons. First, because it was thought that these sensors are too simple to calculate anything. And second, because if we think about this, you don't have enough storage here to really save all the data in case there's an issue. Okay? And finally, they very often don't have the communication capabilities to send to the actual hospital. Okay? So that's what you need to have. Already you see some changes because, well, the Apple Watch can do quite a lot of things and can give you even interactive feedback to see what's going on more or less somehow. Okay? This is the first step that shows a little bit the trend I'm going to show. But let's first understand what are these type of sensors. Okay, so since 2008, we were working with the Intel Health Division Group in Haifa, trying to design an advanced monitoring system for wearable. And we came up with the work that was done in the Shimmer. The Shimmer sensor I'm showing here is a typical example of these devices today. So what does it have? It has a very tiny microcontroller, an MSP430 from TI, less than 50 cents. It has nothing, according to them, an operating frequency of 8 megahertz, far beyond what you can do today with a smartphone, obviously, and very small memory, 10 kilobytes. It has a very good radio, at that moment was the top that they could do, that has an interface for Zigbee, which is an optimized protocol with respect to Bluetooth low energy that can be even lower power in certain conditions, especially for multiple sensors. And finally, it has few sensors, the ECG that we needed, 3 leads, because the minimum requirement for medical ambulatory medical operations is 3 leads, so not you only have 1 point, but typically 3. Then you have accelerometers and gyroscopes to compensate for noise. And then ideally you can have a GPS, that's optional. That's the size, something like this. The clear driving force here for the size is the battery. The battery tells you how much it is, and the rest just follows, because the electronics are much smaller. And how do you decide the size? Simple, Intel made a study, what will the people agree to wear? how big. And based on that, they decide the size, and the rest just was designed accordingly. So what are the constraints to make this system smart? Well, constraints: no floating points, no divisions, limited memory, limited computing power because I only operate at 8 megahertz, and the battery also quite limited. So I cannot put the many sensors. So for Turaj, if he has to do all the signal processing algorithms without floating point and without division, I think it would be quite tough, right? So that's the first idea. Okay, let's see what we can do with this. Initially, anyway, that was not thought for that. It was just for doing streaming. So I get the data from the sensors, I packetize it, and I send it theoretically wirelessly there. Minimum possible consumption I can. So we did that. We made a study, and at that moment, turns out that the maximum we could do was around 5.5 days, 134 hours. That was in 2011. My goal was to prove that the radio was the main problem and go back to the radio guys and say, can you give me a better one? But what turned out to be very surprising was that the radio was not the key bottleneck. The key bottleneck was sensing and sampling. I'm getting a lot of data. There's the analog front end with all the data. And from all this data that I get, 70% of them is useless, but still I send it. So in reality, the most important problem that we need to solve is sensing and sampling. Okay? He said, well, this is because front ends are not good. We just try to see how the thing progresses. We did the same study 2015. Still the same. So maybe a bit better. We do a bit of more processing to filter some data. Radio consumes a bit more because we do it still optimized, but sensing and sampling is the biggest part. So bottom line, the original idea of having sensing, simple sensors sending all over and then getting to the cloud to do the processing doesn't work. That's my claim. So, and I hope I have convinced you with this already. So, okay, now that we know it doesn't work, how can we make it work? That's the key aspect. So, okay, so two challenges. Can we reduce the amount of data sent to the concentrator so that I don't have this energy here? And second, well, if we are going to remove something, we're already doing a bit of processing to filter some. Can we really do much more? Can we do embedded analysis that we solve in one shot automatically the problem that many people have of sending a lot of personal data to the cloud that people are not happy? Okay, so let's try to address the second problem. So of course we cannot change the system. If I change you the system, it's easy. But let me do the same thing with the same design I have. Okay, so we did that. We work since 2011 that we had the results, trying to make a flow that does signal receive, noise filtered, delineated, and then arrhythmia detection. So what does it mean? Basically means I receive the signal with all the noise moving in normal conditions. I have to remove all the noise to be able to analyze it. After that, I have to find all the points, not the peaks, that you very often have in many of the systems. You want to find, for medical purposes, all the fiducial points, which means all the little bumps and so on that you see in the signal. Because if you have a problem on the big peak, which very often you see that people claim, there's no reason for a wearable. You have to be in the hospital. You have a problem on the lower ones, which is how you actually charge and discharge the heart, then you should be monitored because something will happen later on. But that's what you really care. So the doctor is more interested on what happens in these little bumps that are unfortunately completely hidden by noise if you don't filter the noise. So that's why you have to first filter the noise correctly, delineate the signal well, and in the end, and I put it in a different color, you find a way to do analysis, advanced decision making that will filter some of the work of the doctor. Okay? So you need to find a way to do analysis of arrhythmias, for example. And I put it in a different color because here it's not such a big problem to do it in the engineering side. It's more on what the doctor wants to see. And we did this study with 7 doctors. Each doctor has his own rules. And you have to do adaptation, not for the patient, but for the doctor. Okay, just to let you know. Okay, once this thing happens, you don't take a decision, you inform the doctor, so the personnel, the medical personnel receives the information and decides. Next to that, you have to also compress the signal and save it. In case something goes wrong, they can check what happened. Because you cannot only say, there's a possible thing here, the person would like to see what happened a few minutes before and ideally a few minutes after. Okay, so it's a big trouble because you need to compress the signal completely here. Okay, we did all this work. And the proof, I'm going to show you in a second, you can implement all this. In these tiny sensors at 8 megahertz, you can implement it, and still I have space. Okay? So let me show you a video that shows you the system I was just proposing. without changing the same shimmer that we had before that was supposed to be done. So this is the system, the shimmer connecting the system and having the coordinator, which is not doing anything except just displaying the signal if you want. Okay? So it does the whole thing, like I said, filtering, delineation, arrhythmia, and then displays the thing on the iPhone. So I'm going to make the system work in real life. I cannot put you a patient here, but I put you a patient generator, which actually creates all possible arrhythmias that you want. And we are going to see a few of them. So this is the interface that you have to make, so the app. The shimmer connected to our patient with the three leads that you have here. And these are possible arrhythmias that we can generate with noise and sound included on top, OK? So if you have all the system running, well, the system starts getting the signal. It's analyzing the signal already. And at a certain moment in time, I want to connect to it. So I just simply press the button on the phone in the app. And will be at that moment, I'm requesting the system to send me the information. In real operating conditions, it will not work like that. It will be operating alone. And when something goes wrong, it will send me a message. But just for illustration here to show you, I click on the button. Signal comes. You see the signal delineated. Here we're not filtering the noise. So you see how after you filter the noise, you can see the arrhythmias. And the system detects the arrhythmia in real time with a delay of less than 10 seconds. You start seeing another much more subtle arrhythmia, which is this pent here, which is not plain. After a few seconds, another arrhythmia is detected. You say, well, yeah, but what about noise? I put noise. So if I put muscular noise, which is what you saw before, for example, if I move the arms, you suddenly see all the noise here. After you filter, it's actually detecting the points correctly. You breathe. It also creates noise, which actually very often for the Apple Watch, for example, is a problem. Because if you breathe, your signal goes up and down. And it's actually something that seems intuitive for us to see, but it's not so easy to actually detect for an automated device. So the system works. And actually, most interestingly, it doesn't burn more power because computing on the node is cheaper than sending the data out. Instead of 134, I have 139. Okay? So now the second point is, well, does it have value? So we did the study, and we actually work with the doctors here in the shop, and what turns out is it's really effective for them. Because then they remove a lot of visits to the hospital that are potentially not necessary if the person has feedback. Right? So we did a study. We have a whole system we created, a startup called Smart Cardia, which is here in the Parque Scientific. And you could see the original design with the electrodes, because the doctors want to have the electrodes. After that, we thought it was not very wearable, so we gave another design that was with a simple polar belt, $10. Exactly the same result. Doctors, after quite a while, they agreed that actually it's better to send to the guy at home with this than with the three electrodes hanging. Okay? Exactly the same design. See the same thing working. In this case, the signal is filtered, so you see it correctly how the person will see it. Okay? Okay, so smart wearables are possible. We had an extra test that was actually even more challenging, which was with solar impulse. Do you know the pilots that were running over the world with solar energy? OK, so obviously for them, if they have a problem in the middle of the cockpit, it's difficult to see something. So what we came up with them is, can we study what they do and try to monitor them automatically so they feel how they are? So this is one of the flying tests over San Francisco. You see, what we were doing is we were having them trying for 3 years that we were training with the official medical equipment that you could see with clusters all over the place, as well as our sensors. So we had our sensors in the end embedded in the clothing. And you can see that you have to change the form factor, but it's exactly the same thing. So this is the original test that we did with the guy there wearing it. For the pilot, there is an added value because he's going to spend 1 week here. He has arrhythmias, problems that he has to observe. He has to understand if it's really critical or not, because very often one thing is what you feel, another one is what is reality. So if it's really serious. The main point is that for them, instead of having this and having all these wires, this is what is medically certified, he only needs to have this. So you can imagine that the doctor was not very happy to only replace that. But for the pilot, he definitely pushed not to have the medical equipment because having the wires for a week is not very pleasant for him. So the system worked. And actually, the pilot managed to survive the whole flight. So basically, it seems that the system works. OK, so I have proven you that we can do very good with what we have today. Can we do better? So my argument is we can do much better if we try. So the reason why, if we look at the evolution of computing, we can see that we have improved a lot how much we can put in volume in the last 50 years. And we can do here how many operations per joule, per energy we consume. We have improved quite a lot, but we are here. We think about biological systems. We are still three orders of magnitude worse than the brain, for example. And the reason why we are worse than the brain is essentially for three main purposes. One is we have a completely different way where energy efficiency is not well tracked, because in these wearables we have only one microcontroller or microprocessor, pretty general, not specialized. So you need to make it really special for biosignals. Second, the brain is extremely parallel. You don't have one processor. You have millions of cells. Simple ones do the whole process. We don't have that in wearables today. And finally, and it's very interesting, we don't know everything that is around the body. The brain only gets to know a tiny portion of what the brain, of what the whole system is sensing. Why? Because many of these things, although maybe valuable for some reason, are unnecessary to calculate the current requirements. What is the usefulness of analyzing something that something local can solve? Okay? So can we do this? So the final point for this discarding is that you see the sensors that we have distributed on top of the brain, so the peripheral nervous system, is pretty intelligent. We don't get to know that there's something touching us on a tiny part of the body because it's not necessary. So the brain discards all this. We don't need to decide what to do. So how can we do that? Okay, so let's think about discarding. Now that we know the signals, we know that the ECG is pretty much what is called compressible. What does it mean? Basically means that from a very complex ECG signal, you see, so here this is the buffer that we're having in the shimmer, 512 samples of 4 milliseconds each, so 250 hertz. It's a very complicated signal. As you can see, everything has value. But if I find another basis, another representation that is not in the time domain, this is time domain, okay? This is 2 seconds, actually, with 2 bits. If I find a representation where the signal is called sparse, has little information content for the amount of samples I acquire, I can maybe remove some of them. Okay? What does it mean? In the medical domain for a long while, ECG has been decomposed to do the analysis of the points in wavelets. Okay? So if I do the representation of the ECG in wavelets, I get something like this. What does it mean? Turaj knows even better than me. From the wavelet point, means that only these guys have meaning, and all the other guys, I can get rid of them. The problem that we have is that very often you get this data, and once you get this data, you realize that some of them are not useful and you have to throw them. So what compressive sensing is telling you, if I know that the signal is sparse in this domain, I can get a specific way of doing the sampling with a certain measurement matrix that will tell me when do I activate the ADC part to really get the useful points. And the rest, I don't even get them. Okay? So if we do that, my measurement vector, instead of sampling this 512, I will only sample M, which is a number of samples much smaller. So basically, I'm reducing this big part of the pie because I don't need to get it. I don't care about these points. Okay? So of course, there is a part that is it's very simple. Why don't we do it that way always? It's because after this, you only have very few samples. If you want to reconstruct the original signal, you have to run a convex optimization problem, very complicated to really see the original signal. You really want to display it. But if you think about it, where is this thing running? Where do I get in the samples? In the wearable. Where am I showing the signal? On the phone. And the phone that we work on that has a lot of processing power that we don't use for anything. So the decoder runs on the phone. The acquisition of the signal, that is very simple, is on the wearable system. OK, so it seems to be attractive. Does it work? Well, we did the same design, and we remove on purpose, we tweak the system to remove 50% of the data. So you acquire 50% less input signal than what you should. OK, so this is the system, the same shimmer, hack. So that we run the compressive sensing, we encode it, we send it, and then the CS recovery is done on the phone. Okay, so you have here the system, the same one running, our poor shimmer hack all over the place to get the sensing matrix that we want to do and so on. And the system gets the signal from the same way that we had it before. And after we had the signal generated, we send it to the phone encrypted with the same very few samples that you get from the compressive sensing, and the system will decompress it. So This is my signal generated. Well, the quality is not as good as you see on the laptop, but you can see that the signal is fully there. Even the little peaks, they are still there. Even if I include more noise, I still have the signal, even the small peaks. So basically means 50% of my sensing part that was taking a lot of energy, I can remove it completely. And if I remove it, I also do a lot less processing. Okay? So they're wonderful. So we have removed the big part, so it will be much better. You see how much better? In principle, we have removed a huge chunk of computing time, so 23 times, so the energy should be much better. Reality, nothing at all. So instead of raining a lot, for 23 times less computing activity, we only get 37% versus the DWT, so the full compression, and only 6% of doing nothing. Why? We actually do all this and we only save 6%? Simply because our original microcontroller was not optimized for this. Goes back to the first issue of the biological systems. We are not specialized. So we need to specialize the processor. So we work on that. We created our own family with Professor Andreas Burg and 5 students about this. We created different designs. We were able to optimize twice the lifetime of the system by simplifying the system. It's much simpler than the original MSP430. So it's less than 10,000 gates, one full processor, and in 90 nanometer was consuming significantly less than one of the standard microcontrollers. Now, I'm missing a second part. If you say, it's a specialized and parallel. Can we do parallel processing here? So far, there's only one guy processing all the leads. In reality, if we think about ECD, all these leads are treated with the same type of analysis and can be treated in parallel. It's not done, but you can. So we did a design where you have multiple of these processors working all in parallel at a much lower frequency. Much slower. And what turns out is that if you take the single design, the design with a single core, you need to make it to fulfill the requirements of operations per second that you need to do. You need to have, for the three leads, you need to have an operating frequency for voltage and supply and frequency that requires 0.9 volts. If you do it with a multicore, first you have a much higher computing capability in case you want to increase the number of leads. And second, you can have a supply voltage for the three lead case which is much lower. What I mean is that you reduce the frequency and the voltage. So you can not run fast, but it doesn't matter because you don't need it. So overall, you actually have a system that is able to give you 6 times the lifetime of the original design. So from running only from 5.5 days or 7 days in the best case, you can make the system work for almost a month with the same battery. Okay? So if you see, we are not the only ones that have thought about it. And for example, if you have seen the announcement of the new Apple Watch, the Series 2, it already includes a dual core processor. It's true that one part is for the graphics, but you have specialized graphics, and you have a dual core processor that they can use for very advanced processing. So it's much more going on into the smart systems or the wearables. So this is what you see trend. I can claim that we can do really, really much more extreme on the advanced processing on the nodes. So what else? Well, if you think about it, we have the processors now specialized. One thing that we didn't exploit is that we learn. We typically learn things, right? Not very frequently, but we tend to learn things sometimes. So in this case, we tend to learn things from things that arrive to us. So today we are in a situation where everybody is connected with this idea of big data. I'm not saying you cannot use cloud computing to do process, but you should use it with care. Okay? So you have all the data connected. So everybody is there. You're getting a huge amount of information that you can process. Even science is actually using it to refine our theories with new simulations and so on. Can we use this in the wearables? The answer is yes, but when we really need it. What does it mean? It means that if we have a certain design and we include some knowledge about how the pacing works, we can make it multi-parametric and, for example, create, like in this case, a new design that can analyze blood pressure by just by using the microphone or the heart, how it does, and the pulse sensor, which is the new design that is actually shown here. Another one that you can do, you can use this machine learning and knowledge from many patients how they really use the device to create a system that can be a bracelet, but can also be a wrist. Depending where you put it, it will adapt itself to how it should operate. So you don't have to need to have two sensors. You have the same sensor. Sometimes you use it here, sometimes you use it here. Is it possible? Yes, it is. And the same technology. For both, for both designs, exactly the same technology. This is the new design that SmartCardia is going to commercialize early next year. So, okay, but if we do that and we start looking into this area, we can do more things, but we want to do even more. What can we do to do even more? Well, first, last thing I have is that even the processors I have shown you are small. They're not as small as a neuron, okay? And they're not as specialized as a neuron, okay? There are many small kernels in these biosignals, now that we know more, that can actually be executed very well in a specialized custom hardware, okay? So what you can do, instead of having a simple design with multiple cores that they're all homogeneous, we can make an heterogeneous architecture of multiple processors for wearables that if you identified some of the signals that are from data coming from the banks that are really necessary, we do like in the brain, we use hardware specialization. So some parts of the system will be ready to process this even better. If we find these kernels, we can do it well, right? How do we do that? Well, we look at the kernels that run in these wearables. We find how they should be mapped to different parts of the brain. And in our brain, which is this guy, we create a specialized system that has these tiny cells that take the data, process this data, and feed it back to the system. Okay? So the ideas I have, if I have something I don't know what to do, I give it to the normal processor. If it's some kernel I know what to do, I give it to my specialized cells. Okay? So this can give value. Yes, we actually ran some experiments already, and you can have benefits of up to 20%. 18 to 20% energy reductions if you do this type of things. So can you do it more extensively? I'm sure that there's plenty of things that we are going to be studying with a number of years, with the students that are there for a number of years, that we will actually be studying this. So I hope I have convinced you that, as a conclusion, that wearable devices are getting everywhere, even in everybody, but they are not yet where they should be. They should be much more intelligent and specialized. And if we do these two things together, we can definitely have the new smart wearables coming up. So last but not least, I would like to acknowledge that this is not my idea. It's actually something that Mr. Spock in the 80s proposed in this tricorder, famous tricorder, was able to do all these things and communicating with the enterprise, actually without any problem, in the matter of milliseconds. So thank you very much.